A reading from the second book of Samuel. Now, when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. When he commits iniquity, I will punish him with a rod such as mortals use, with blows inflicted by human beings."
Place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they as he went a great crowd, and he had compassion for them, because they were like a sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to the land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him, and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. Here ends the reading.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I want to start this morning by thanking Katrina for the invitation to join you all. Given how long she and I have been friends, it's actually a bit hard for me to believe that this is my first time in this building. But then, as Katrina said, I've just finished 4 full-time years at Trinity Episcopal Church in Southport. So I suppose we've both been keeping ourselves pretty busy. Nonetheless, it is a joy to be with you all this morning. One thing people learn about me pretty quickly is that I am a big fan of Star Trek. I can barely remember a time before The Next Generation had started airing, and I've kept up with all the TV series and movies that have come out since. For a long time, however, I was less familiar with the original series, an error I've since corrected. But I'd always been a fan of that crew's movies, having seen them multiple times before ever seeing an episode of the original show. In Star Trek V, The Final Frontier, the Enterprise and its crew are hijacked and taken to the center of the galaxy where they hope to meet God, living on a planet there. Once on the surface, the being they encounter does indeed seem to manifest all the glory of the divine. But before long, it becomes clear that something isn't quite right. During the conversation, this entity asks if the starship they've traveled on could carry his wisdom back out into the galaxy. The camera quickly pans to Captain Kirk, who politely raises his hand and says, "Excuse me, I'd just like to ask a question. What does God need with a starship?" From that point on, it's pretty obvious to everyone assembled that the person they're talking to, no matter how powerful, is not God. If the story of King David were being written in the 23rd century, I could easily imagine God asking, "What do I need with a starship?" in today's reading from 2 Samuel. As the first lines of the passage suggest, David has just finished a long campaign of securing the borders of his kingdom. This campaign included his conflict with Saul, Israel's first king. To say that the character of David is complicated is to simplify his narrative beyond the point of usefulness. However, he has one characteristic that is important to consider here. Like the apostles after him, David keeps assuming he knows what God wants and keeps getting it wrong. But at the heart of most of his decisions is the desire to please God, which in fact does please God. Having consolidated and secured his kingdom, David decides to do what any good king in the ancient Near East would have done: build a temple to his God to give thanks and to solidify his somewhat questionable claim to the throne. The separation of church and state that we sometimes take for granted today would have been inconceivable just a few hundred years ago. During the reign of David, religion and politics were, for all intents and purposes, the same thing. By building a temple, David was attempting to say that his God was with him here and now, just as God had been with him during his conquests. It would have legitimized his claim and satisfied the needs and wants of his people who had rallied around David by the name of the Lord. God, however, has other things in mind. "Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?'" The theology of the time suggested that gods were local. They were attached to a particular place, and if a person moved, they left their god behind and adopted the god of their new homeland. It's a bit like how I feel about professional sports teams. Now, I'm always going to feel an affinity to the places I've lived before, but I'm just as happy to cheer for the team of wherever I'm living. Mind you, being in Connecticut complicates things a bit because we're divided between New York and Boston, so I stay pretty neutral here and only really pay the mildest of notice to my former hometown. Go Blue Jays. The God of Israel, however, isn't tied to one place. "Thus says the Lord, 'Are you, David, the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle.'" God cannot be housed or contained. God does not sit still. God is prepared to be with the people wherever they are. The tabernacle may be the place God's people go to, but only because humanity has need of those kinds of signs and symbols that remind us that our encounters with God, our worship of God, is meant to be something outside the ordinary and beyond the everyday. The buildings help us, certainly, but they are far from necessary for God's presence to be among us. As the children's song says, "God is with us wherever we go. So rejoice." We see something of this in our gospel passage this morning. Jesus is coming and going, traveling around the countryside and preaching the word of God. Wherever he is, wherever his message is heard, the people of God are. Jesus will eventually refer to his own body as the temple, reminding us that humans made in God's image carry God with us each and every day. We already have all we need to meet and praise God, no matter where we are. Simply by being present among the people, Jesus creates the church, the body of Christ, wherever he is. A church that, through the power of the Holy Spirit, survives even after he leaves. His message and his ministry cannot be contained. God is with us wherever we go, so rejoice. What does God need with a starship, indeed? On Thursday, I got back from spending 2 weeks in northwestern Virginia volunteering as a youth chaplain at Shrinemont Camps, run by the Episcopal Diocese of Virginia. Never having gone to camp much as a kid, I didn't really know what to expect or if I'd be any good at it. Yes, for the last 4 years, I have been a youth minister, but in a very different context. And the truth is, I was a bit burnt out by my last job, and I wasn't sure my heart would be in it. As it turned out, I needn't have worried. Working with youth in a camp context energized me in a way I hadn't experienced before. And after my first couple of sessions, word started getting back to me that not only were the campers enjoying their chaplain's times with me, but that some were saying I was one of the best chaplains they'd ever had. The compliments were welcome. My ego certainly enjoyed the boost. And I could have easily continued doing things that I thought would keep me popular. So I had to stop and ask myself what those compliments meant and how I would respond to them. When things are going well, it's easy to get distracted by success, to take all the credit for ourselves and assume that the praise is what we're doing it for. That wasn't why I had gone to camp. I had to remind myself that I was there for the campers. For many of these youth, camp was a safe haven, the only place where they could be truly themselves. First and foremost, I was there to be a shepherd for them. I was there to meet their needs, to give them permission to grow and flourish as themselves, and to share the love of God with them. And if that message resonated, then it was because God's love was being manifested in the moment. My job was to stay out of the way as that love continued to grow. Love begins with God. As the first letter of John says, "Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. We love because God first loved us." To have centered myself and take credit for that love would have been to put my own needs and wants first and God's will second. In the same way for King David, the question of building God's house is more than simply a matter of theology. It is a question of motivation. When announcing to Nathan he's going to build a temple, David says all the right things. "See now," he says, "I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." If David has nice things, God should too, right? David thinks he's doing the right thing, but he doesn't quite get it. As we've seen, David's motivation has as much, if not more, to do with securing his political power as it does with honoring God. And so, God reminds David that God has no need of a house, and that our intentions matter. When we confuse our own will and our own desires with those of God, we separate ourselves from God. For God, the reasons we do a thing are just as important, if not more so, than what we're doing in the first place. The right action for the wrong motivation may not be the right action after all. A temple will eventually get built by David's son, Solomon, only to be destroyed by Babylon a few centuries later. What Israel relearns in the aftermath of that moment is that God cannot be contained. God is not tied to the land like other gods. God has no need of a starship. God is already with us wherever we go. So, rejoice. Amen.